many smiling faces this morning, and I don't know about you, but I heard several people as we were coming in this morning talking about enjoying the nice cooler mornings. Aren't we thankful that we're starting to see a little bit nicer temperatures out there? We are glad that you're here. We are hoping that you are as excited as we are for this time of worship together this morning. Let's go ahead and start off with a word of prayer. God, we thank you so much for today. We thank you for each of those who are gathered here and those who are joining us online as well. God, we just ask that you would be with us this morning. We are so thankful for the many blessings, such as cooler weather that you have given us and in our lives. God, help us to not forget those in the midst of trials in this life. Help us to remember that your promises are true and that you have called us to follow you. Help us this morning as we are entering into your courts with praise and thanksgiving. Be with us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Join me this morning in a responsive reading as we respond to exactly what these gentlemen have sang. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. The righteous, they cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from trouble. And what does the Lord require of me?
That I act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with my God.
Glorify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together.
Good morning, church. It's so good to see you all here. Why don't we stand and sing our first song, that we would open our eyes, that we may see glimpses of truth that God has for us.
Mm-hmm.
you, Linda and gentlemen. If you have your Bibles this morning, I'm going to encourage you to turn to the book of Micah chapter 6. If you're watching us online this morning, grab your Bible. We're going to be in the book of Micah chapter 6. We have verse 8 on the screen. If you'll let me, I'm going to read two verses prior to that. And Tracy this morning asked me, she said, do you want to update scripture? And I said, no, just leave it at 8. But Tracy, appreciate your patience with that. With what shall I come to the Lord and bow myself before him on high? Shall I come to him with burnt offerings, with yearling calves? Does the Lord take delight in thousands of rams and 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I present my firstborn for my rebellious acts, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He's told you, old man, what is good and what it is that the Lord requires of you. Simply do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God.
Thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you for how it challenges us, how it comforts us, how it encourages us. We pray that we would be drawn closer and closer to you every day. Help it to be important to us to spend time in your word. And Lord, remind us today that what you require of us is that we do justly, we love mercy, and we walk humbly with you. Lord, we want to do that. We want to just be closer and closer to you all the time. And Lord, you've taught us what we need to say when we pray to you. So hear us as we pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Our special music today is an oldie but goodie. I used to sing this as a child, and I don't know about you, but And I remember my parents singing it. I was taken a little back when we were doing the prelude before the service. I don't know if you heard or knew what the title of the song was. I think it was, oh, I'm sorry. I knew that. I had it right on the tip of my tongue. I'm sorry. It took a miracle. It took a miracle for me to find that page. But it talks about how my God is omnipotent. He's all-knowing. He's all-seeing. He knows all of it. And because of that, he knows the way through our wilderness, through our high times, through our low times, anything that we have coming on. And so as we sing today, understand and claim that God knows the way through the wilderness that you're going through. And what it calls for us to do is decide that we're going to follow him through that wilderness. Ready?
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Linda, thank you for the way you are just mixing up with the men and the women. That was a blessing today. Thank you so much. Again, if you have your Bibles, congregation, turn to the book of Micah chapter 6. I want to start again by saying good morning, church.
Good morning.
And those online, I'm hoping that you said good morning or something. So good to be here with you this morning, and I hope and pray that you had a week that was blessed. I hope that yesterday many of you participated in the digital or online prayer journey, and you watched that or listened to it. We're at a unique time in our world, and if there's ever been a time that we as believers need to be on our face begging God for direction, for his perfect will to be accomplished in our lives, it's now. Now, I had the privilege of spending a great time Friday with some guys, and we were talking, and it's not often that when you're 50, 7:58, however old I am, that you feel like the young guy on the block, okay? But I was with so many old guys on Friday that I felt like I was maybe in junior high again, all right? But as we're talking, and as I was listening to some of the stories, and as we talked about the needs of our community and our country and our leaders, my heart was literally broken as your pastor, thinking and taking that to maybe a depth deeper, that we do live in a time, and we're going through a season of life that we're probably, if we're asking it out loud, that's okay, by the way. God's shoulders are more than broad enough to allow us to do it, but you might be doing it privately in your own prayer time, asking something like this: God, what is it you want from me? What do you want? It's good to have Jerry Sandy again with us today. And Jerry, we want you to know that we love you and we have been praying diligently for you and we'll continue to do so. And you're just a blessing to us. I saw him earlier. I don't know if he... There you are. Sandvig, we love you. I'm going to ask you to do me a favor, though. About a year ago, on the prayer through the email, you got a request that you would pray for a very good friend of mine and Mona's. His name's Quint. Now, if you remember, Quint's a young man. I had the privilege to watch he and his wife grow up. I was their youth pastor for a while. Quint went off to join the Marines, and then he came back, and I again had the great privilege to do marriage counseling with them and perform their marriage ceremony. They went on to have two beautiful children. One of their son went on to follow in his father's footsteps, and right now he serves in the United States Marine Corps, doing an awesome job. And it was hard enough to pray for Quint as he went through so many setbacks. And so many of you, you've been down this road where they began trying to correct some very serious medical issues. And at first, toes were being amputated, then a foot. Then they had to come in and take a leg. And you very graciously as a church, you walked with us and prayed with us through that season and with them. I'm happy to say that Quint right now is doing really well. He has a prosthetic and he's walking well, and God has just really done some very unique and good things. But there's a backstory there. Backstory that most folks don't know, but it's this, that as a young couple, they have fought the fight of life. His wife went through a time where she was diagnosed with cancer, and then they went through that, and then they had the season of Quint's setbacks, and then while she was ministering to Quint, because she just had to be there 24/7, she lost her job, and then she went through the trials and the tribulation of saying, I've got to care for my husband, and he's on disability, and they were making these journeys, and they were going through it. And I often thought how much for a young couple to have to go through. And then I learned this Friday that if that wasn't enough, they had to take their youngest daughter in, 17 or 18 years old, Mona. They found a tumor on her brain in the back of her eye. And they took her in, and unfortunately, with all that's going on with COVID, mom and dad couldn't be there. They were not allowed in. They were not allowed. In fact, they basically, from my understanding, they said, y'all go home and we'll contact you when she gets out of surgery and we'll let you know how everything's going, but you can't stay here. Now, I know there are many of us in this room that were parents. And it would have been tough for us to make that move. We'd have been camping out in the parking lot. We'd have been wherever we could be. And then they got the phone call that said, and again, I'm paraphrasing much of this, that their daughter had not awoken from surgery yet, and they weren't sure that if there was bleeding on the brain and or if she was just having a hard time in coming out from the anesthesia. But they sent out a text, and they said, please, would you pray? And as we got that text, Mona and I talked, how much more can a young couple go through? How much more can they do? And as I've been studying for this week and last week, I want you to know I had another opening illustration, but my heart, late last night or early this morning, really, I was drawn to that because it is so real and because so many in this room, that really is your life story right now. We don't know when the week's going to end and when we can take a breath, when everything is going to subside. And maybe today you're struggling with the loss of a loved one like so many in this room are. There's a personal illness that you're grappling with, or you're listening, and it's loss of employment. Maybe it's isolation that finally has taken its toll. Or you're worried about the unrest in our world, in our nation. Maybe for some it's just that elusive peace within your heart and your life that you do everything you can to go after and you can't seem to find it. And then if we're not careful, we allow the frustration to slip in. And we begin to ask God, what have I done wrong? What's going on? And I want to give you the end of today's message in advance. Y'all, we've not done anything wrong. If you are facing life circumstance, and if you're struggling right now, we do not have a God in heaven that waits for us with this big hammer called life, waiting to hit us on the head as soon as we step out of line. If that were the truth, your pastor wouldn't be here preaching today, okay? He would be healing from the knots on his head. But we have a God that has, according to what Scripture says, suffered and gone through everything that we suffer and go through, and he's been victorious in it. But yet we are asked, would you follow me in the midst of all of life's circumstance? God, what do you want from me? Whether the days are great or whether they're tough, what do you want from me when I feel like I'm on top of the world, or in those days that it's all I can do to simply just throw my feet over the mattress and get out of bed? And we find ourselves in the book of Micah. And here's what's great about this passage. It is the picture. In fact, if you'll go through, you could knock this out this afternoon. Read the book of Micah, and as you get into chapter 6, you find that we're in, again, as in so many times in Scripture, we find ourselves in God's courtroom. So I'm going to ask that you put a little bit of imagination and animation in your mind for a second as we look at this passage. God is in the courtroom. He is the judge. And we find ourselves in his presence asking God, what is it you really want from us? Now, I want to tell you, there are those that love to separate the Old Testament from the New Testament, and they don't want to tie the two together. And I want you right now, as we begin to talk about Micah, I want to remind you of the book of 1 John chapter 2, verse 1, which says, oh yeah, we're in another courtroom, aren't we? I have an advocate. My attorney is Jesus. That's what it says. I have an advocate with the Father. As a child of God, I have an advocate. My attorney is Jesus. And every time the evil one wants to throw something up in with my name, saying, if you knew that scoundrel Mitch, God, here's what you would be saying. And I'm just, maybe I'm being a little too animated. Forgive me if I am, all right? But I think Jesus gets up there and just lets him ramble for a little bit. Yo, Mitch, he did this or he did that. And then Jesus kind of just politely waves his hand in front of his Father and shows that nail-pierced hand and says, I object. And God the Father looks at that nail-pierced hand. And he looks at the devil and he says, next. Is that the best you really have? I have an advocate with the Father. But because I have an advocate with the Father, I better take the circumstances and my situations in life seriously and ask the Father, the judge, God, what is it you want to do in my life in the midst of hard times? What is it that you expect out of me? God, what do you want from me? And not in a negative way. I want us to turn that question into the positive. God, I'm in over my head right now. What would you like me to do within this mess? We are so guilty at times when everything's not going right of slipping into a rut that is a poor, pitiful me. Look at what I'm dealing with. You know, it was interesting when my mother died. My brother, my father, and I were in the hospice. She was in a hospice house, and we were there, and my mom passed away. And it was interesting for my father, and he mentioned this months later. I was on my mother's left-hand side. My brother was on my mother's right-hand side. My dad was kind of right up over her head, and we're loving on her, and we're talking to her, and we literally were there when she drew that last breath, and my brother said, this is not fair. Now that is a mindset, isn't it? There's a mindset that when we go through a hard time, or we lose a loved one, there's a mindset that says, this is not fair. And it wasn't because it was Mitch the preacher. It wasn't because I wanted to pick a fight with my brother. It was simply because I may not have been listening. I may have been exhausted. But I looked up at my brother over my mom's body and I said, what's not fair about this? Man, she'd been sick for so long and God finally took her home. And what is not, this is a fair thing here. And my brother said, how can you say that? And my dad, I'll never forget the look on his face. He's like, they're going to have an argument right here. There are two perspectives, aren't there? So no matter what perspective, no matter what you walked in with today, I want to ask you just for 1 second, draw yourself within that courtroom. And know that you have things in your life that I don't pretend to understand or know. Hurts, fears, loneliness. And the list goes on and on and on. But I want to ask you if you would do me a favor and let's approach the bench where my Heavenly Father is the judge. But let's approach it with confidence knowing that I have an advocate in Christ Jesus and all he wants to hear out of my life is, God, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do with this? Now, it's interesting when you look at this passage because it literally, theologians tell us, but I've read a lot of them this week, okay? Theologians tell us that that is the exact setting that God's people found themselves in. What God requires of man, no matter what. What God is asking of us as believers, no matter how you walked in, no matter what your situation in life is, we have to ask ourselves the question, God, what do you want me to do? What do you want from me? Beginning with verse 6. We're going to pick it up with that one that's standing in front of the where the judge sits, what's that called? Bench. Standing in front of the bench. That was an easy answer. I knew that answer. I feel stupid. That one that is just curious as to what God desires is standing in front of the bench, and he comes before the Heavenly Father, and he says, With what shall I come to the Lord? How do I approach you, Your Honor? How do I approach you, God? And understand, they don't make answers up, but they address God within their historical and social setting. Too many times we read this and we think, man, they're just pulling stuff out of the sky. Understand this. Their answers in the next few moments are very relevant. And they're relevant, and we need to be reminded that we may come up with answers too. And when we ask God, what do you want from me? With what shall I bring, and how shall I come before a holy God? Option number one. Take notes today, y'all. How do you approach a holy God? Do you come and bow yourself before him on high? Do I need to come and bow down before God? In church council meeting on Monday, we were visiting and right before the meeting, and Bud Carter, who's chairman of the church council, I had handed him a book to read, and Bud, you never think guys are going to read this stuff, okay? He read it! And he opens it up during church council, and he says, Mitch, you've let us down. I said, do what? He said, this book was powerful. I said, what did it say? I'd read it, but I wasn't sure where he was going. And he said, Mitch, it is up to you as our pastor to walk us through the process of what it means to be worshipers of God. Amen. And if I have failed you in that area, I want to ask you to forgive me. But over the next few months and next few weeks, we are going to focus on what it means to worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And this first person comes and says, "With what shall I come to the Lord? Bow myself before him on high. Shall I come to him with a burnt offering? Will burnt offerings do it?" Can I be honest with you that during this time in the history of religiosity, burnt offerings were being offered to all kinds of gods. It was a normalcy for people to bring an offering to a god. But we're not talking about a god. We're not talking about an option for worship. One of our members has been ministering and caring for a friend of theirs. They were telling me just this morning, they said, man, it is so tough to do ministry. They're so intelligent, and they have all these different things that they believe. And I want to encourage you with this, that there are people in the world that have a lot of beliefs, but they don't have the Holy Spirit. You have the Holy Spirit of God. You not only have an advocate in court, but you have a great tackler going before you as you enter into battle each and every day of your life, and that's the Holy Spirit of God. And he blocks for us, and he gives us the right words, and he gives us the right movements, and he puts us in the right place at the right time, and gives us the ability to recall that we might love people in the name of Jesus. Just simply love them. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, not being judgmental, not being ugly, simply just saying, I love you, and God loves you and has an amazing plan for your life. So do I come before God and do I offer burnt offerings or with calves? Does the Lord delight in the ram? Does the Lord delight in thousands of rams, in 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I present? Now listen, this is interesting, and many read this and they're like, wow, should I present my firstborn? Understand that is not something that is a crazy request. During this time, especially, we know that history teaches us there was a god Moloch. And history tells us that even when Abraham was told to take Isaac, it wasn't a crazy request because it was happening everywhere. It was crazy for Abraham because he's like, man, God's never asked me to do something like this. But he knew that if he followed God in obedience, that God would take care of the details. Do you ever get caught in the details? Do you ever just get caught in trying to process, are trying to run things down, and we feel like we must have all the answers all the time. And I'm drawn to the fact that the judge, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that sits on his throne has those answers for me. And he wants me to trust him. He reminds me, Mitch, I've given you an advocate in my son. If you have a personal relationship with him, then you've been given carte blanche. And I've given you the Holy Spirit that we can communicate constantly. I am never out of being an access for you. I read yesterday on the internet, as we look at the confirmation of a new Supreme Court justice, that she had written when she was confirmed before, someone asked her, you've got all these kids. How can you legislate and offer great judicial promise or fulfill your judicial obligations and still be a parent? And I'm paraphrasing this answer, and I couldn't find it this morning. I looked. But her paraphrase answer was this. Well, my children know how to get a hold of me. Don't mistake that. My children know where I am 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. But I also can't perform the duties I've been called to perform. Now, think about this. You know what our Heavenly Father can do right now? We are a congregation, maybe 30 of us in this room. I don't know how many. And the 30 of us in this room, we have access to God, right? But you want to know something else that's amazing? I've got friends in Maricopa right now, and they're doing church the same as we are, and they have access to Him. And God can perform the same things in our midst that He does there, but He's not limited to that because He is so big and He's so powerful and He's so mighty. He's also doing these things all across the world at this very moment. He is being God while He allows His children to have access to the throne. God, what do you want from me? First thing He wants us to do is realize you're never alone. You are never, ever alone. Should I bring a calf? No, it's not about doing something. If I had thousands of rams, God, and 10,000 rivers of oil, I don't need any rams, and I've got all the oil I need. Should I give my firstborn? Should it be like the worshipers of Baal or the worshipers of Moloch? Would I do that? No, I don't need your firstborn. Here is what I want you to do. Now again, as we get into verse 8, it's just amazing that the holy word of God, we can tie Micah 6:8 to the New Testament. When you read these words, I'm going to ask you, just try to remember that God gave us, the Apostle Paul, when he wrote the church in Ephesus, he said, hey, there are these things called the fruit of the Spirit. And if we as followers of Jesus Christ, no matter what kind of rut we get in or turmoil we're in, if we would simply rely on this, what's God want with my life in the midst of all this? He wants me to exercise the fruit of the Spirit. He wants me to simply realize that people are watching you. And if they see that I am living and I am working in your life, they're going to wonder how they can get me in their life. You see, that it, all God wants us to do. He's told you, old man or old woman or young man or young woman, what's good and what the Lord requires of thee, to do justly, love mercy, and just simply walk humbly with me. God, what do you want from me? Decide now. Decide right now that you are going to do what's right, no matter how wrong everything else seems. Sometimes I get bored, I start flipping through the channels. I'm probably making a mistake by getting ready to admit this. And I think Mona's praying right now, oh God, keep him quiet. They have got this show on TV called Court Cam. Oh man. You just think we're around crazy people, okay? They have cameras in courts all around the world, and they have made a show out of watching people do crazy things in court. Yesterday, it was research for my message today, all right? It was research. That's the only reason I was watching it, research. There was one incident that a man had killed his wife, and he was being sentenced, and the father of the woman that was killed, they interviewed him, and he said, this is going to be my last chance. He put a suit on but wore tennis shoes. He did. I can't make this up. He said, I look good, but I have my tennis shoes on because I knew I was going to have to jump something to get to him. And just as the judge begins to pronounce judgment, this guy comes from out of nowhere. And I'm telling you, those tennis shoes must have had jet oil on them or something, because he flies over a little wall and tackles this guy. Now, can I tell you what's wrong with that? Number one, that's really not a good way to behave in public, all right? But he was not given the right to extend justice. Oh, he wanted to, didn't he? You ever just want to get even? You ever just want to get back at somebody? You ever just want, and you know in the back of your mind that if everything were equal, if I could be God for just one day, you'd set the world right, wouldn't you? Yeah, you wouldn't. You know what's interesting is the very next clip they showed after that was a clip of a young man that in a drive-by shooting killed a 14-year-old little boy. And as they're offering, or the judge, before the judge extends judgment on this young man, they asked the mother if she wanted to say anything to the defendant. And she stood up, walked to the podium, and began to tell that young man how precious he was in God's sight. She began to tell that young man that God loves you and God has a plan for your life, and I do not have the energy or the wherewithal to be mad at you forever because I'm worried about where you're going to spend forever. She made a decision at some point in her life that no matter what life had to throw at her, she was going to do right. Not because of who she was, but because of who God was in her. He's told us that when we're in a mess, do justice. Like that mother, love kindness. That word love, and I know we've been told there are only three words for love, and I hate to break this to you, that's not really necessarily true. There are about eight words that the Bible uses. No, take that back. There are six words the Bible uses to talk about love. And in the Hebrew, this is a love is called ahav. Ahav. I can't roll my H's like I'm supposed to. Ahav. And it's a human love. It's a love that one person has for another, but not a husband-wife love, not an ecstasy, but it's a love that says, I care enough for you to want the best for you. Now, that is a beautiful love. I care enough for you that I want the best for you, and I want the best for you no matter what my circumstance is. What would life be like if we just, where we live, work, and play, if we began to love people that way? Just loved them that way. This week down here at Bash's, I was checking out, and I was able to witness an attack, not physical, but a very angry gentleman didn't like the way the woman bagged his groceries. And man, did he let her know. And he let her know, and he let her know, and he let her know. And then he finally just got mad and walked on. And when I walked up behind her, I thought, this is either going to be a really good experience or a really bad experience for me. And she looked, when I walked up, she looked at me and said, "Sir, I'm sorry you had to hear that." I said, I'm good. And I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to bag my own groceries. How's that? I'm going to bag all these. You don't have to worry about them. God wants us to love people. And when we're caught up in how unfair life is to us, we're not focusing on how to take our circumstance in life and turn it into an opportunity to not just do justice, but to love kindness, to love someone else in humanity with a love that wants the best for them. And then finally, God, what do you want from me? I want you to decide you're going to do right before you need to do right. I want you to decide that you're going to love others around you based on the love I give you. But ultimately, will you just walk humbly with me? You know what I learned this week? Walking humbly with God is this. It doesn't mean that I'm walking in a journey by myself. But when God said in the Hebrew, walk humbly with your God, he was simply was saying, come go on a walk with me. Walk humbly with me. There's the story many of you have heard about a young man that grew up in a very wealthy family in the East, on the East Coast. He was an only child, and he had gone through high school, got into college, and was doing a great job. And his father, again, was very well off. And his father asked him, have you been thinking about for graduation? And he said, you know, Dad, there's this convertible down at the car lot. And I've got good grades, and I've done well, and you can afford it. That's what I like. And graduation comes and goes, and his dad called him into the study at their house. He said, son, I want you to know how I'm so very proud of you. You've done such a good job. You got in there and you rolled your sleeves up and you did the work and you did everything you needed to do. And I am so proud of you. And he hands his son a box. Son starts to think, that's a pretty big box for a set of keys. He opens the box, and inside that box is a beautiful leather-bound Bible. And he looked at the Bible, and he looked at his father, and he said, you could have afforded to give me anything. You could have done anything. You knew what I wanted, but yet you hand me a Bible. And he dropped the Bible on his father's desk. He turned around and left the house, and for years never spoke to his father again. Years passed. He got a call one day from the funeral home. His father had died. He needed to come home to take care of the final affairs. He was standing in his father's study and looked on the shelf and noticed that Bible. Noticed that his father, for all those years, had kept the Bible. He walked over and began to thumb through the Bible, and he found the passage that was underlined. Matthew chapter 7, verse 11 said this, "And if ye being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more
shall your heavenly Father, which is in heaven, give to those who ask. He thought, he was perplexed, and as he turned the Bible, a key fell out of the bottom of the Bible. And it was taped to a business card from that car dealership down the road, and all it said was paid in full. See, he was too proud to walk with the Father. He was too proud to come before the Father and say, Father, what do you want from me now? You know what God wants from us? Each and every one of us that have the joy and the privilege and the honor of coming before that heavenly bench. To say, Father, I am not going to bring you rams because you already have them. I'm not going to bring you oil because you invented it and you've got enough. You don't want me to sacrifice one of my children. You want my heart on the throne. You want me to decide that I'm going to do right before I need to do right. I'm going to love those around me, and I am going to make a commitment with my life that I am going to walk humbly next to you. Father, give us the ability to humble ourselves, to love those around us, and to decide, I'm going to do right. I'm going to do right before I even get there. In Jesus' name.
Starting with next Sunday, immediately after our worship time, We will have a fellowship time outside on the patio, so kind of still trying to be safe and careful and socially distant, but also wanting to be able to have time to just fellowship with one another and bring that back in. We're also then the following, that next Monday, going to be reengaging with our prayer fellowship time in the office at 9:30 on Monday mornings together in person. So we'll still be on Zoom this week. We'll get an email about that later today. But next Monday, we'll resume that and reengage in person. And then on that same Wednesday night, the first Wednesday in October, we will reengage in Wednesday night Bible study together in person in the church office at 6:30 p.m. So we wanted to let you know about these things. You can share that with others as well, that we are going to be reengaging together. And just a minute after the worship team closes us, we will be headed out. You'll be dismissed once again from the back of the room towards the front, and the offering buckets are at the door on your way out. So with that, Linda.
We're glad you came today, and we hope you enjoy your whole week and find all kinds of opportunities to practice what you learned today. God bless you.
Here, did I keep going?